Ever wondered what the Earth was like and what other life was around when the dinosaurs roamed? Well, in this video, I'm going to be talking about life on Earth during the Cretaceous period. And this period is in the Mesozoic era, as shown on this timeline here, going from oldest to youngest, from right to left. The Mesozoic era here is circled, and the last period within the Mesozoic era is the Cretaceous period that went from around 145 to 65 million years ago. The first bit of life I want to talk about that was living in the Cretaceous and dominating in the Cretaceous was microbial life that actually gave the Cretaceous its name. Creta means chalk, and the life responsible for the huge chalk deposits characteristic of the Cretaceous period was Coccolithophores and foraminifera. A Coccolithophore is shown at the bottom right here. They're basically nanoalgae, and they accumulated in crazy amounts during the Cretaceous period, creating the fine grain calcitic rock called chalk. And the reason they accumulated in such crazy amounts during this period is due to an all-time low in the magnesium to calcium ratio of the oceans at this time. This has to do with ocean crust formation, the rate of ocean crust formation, and the rate of alteration at mid-ocean ridges. I talk about all of this in my biogeochemistry part 2 video. You can check it out. I will link it up to the top right for you. But basically, the low magnesium to calcium ratio of the ocean favored calcite precipitation over aragonite precipitation. And these organisms, since they precipitated calcite, dominated during this time. I'll talk later in the video about some organisms that like to precipitate aragonite that suffered during this time. Before we get to the macro life, really quickly, the other major microbiological thing going on during this time was siliceous precipitating organisms, such as diatoms, proliferated to the point that all the silica in the ocean was basically used up for diatoms, and siliceous sponges that used to form large silica reefs, which a glass reef would have been amazing to have in modern day, but we don't have it anymore because at this turning point in Earth's history, these diatoms used up so much of the silica that the siliceous sponges were never again able to form reefs like they did before around 100 million years ago during the Cretaceous period. Moving on now to the macro life, we'll start with plants because there was a major change in plant evolution during the Cretaceous. The major change was the evolution of angiosperms. Angiosperms are flowering plants, and the major difference between angiosperms and gymnosperms that came before them is that gymnosperms, aka naked seed plants, are exactly what their name suggests. They had naked seeds. They weren't enclosed like the angiosperm seeds were. And these angiosperms or flowering plants not only evolved in the Cretaceous, but also went crazy with diversification and dominated a lot of the terrestrial environment in the Cretaceous. However, gymnosperms weren't replaced by any means by angiosperms. They also dominated and continued to diversify as well. It's just the angiosperms came on the scene and made their name known. The quick success of the angiosperms was likely due to two major factors. The first one was double fertilization. This double fertilization process in angiosperms includes the first fertilization, which is producing the seed, and the second one that produces a stored nutrient supply for that seed. This allowed for very quick reproduction cycles compared to that of gymnosperms. Gymnosperms have a reproductive cycle of around 18 months or longer, whereas that of angiosperms could be just a few weeks. The second major factor that played a role in the success of angiosperms was pollination. Flowers obviously attract insects, as we can see with this bee here, and insects benefit from the flower's nectar, and the flowers benefit from the insects carrying around pollen from flower to flower, fertilizing them as they go. You can see all the pollen on this bee here. He's doing a lot of work for those flowers. And this not only played a role for angiosperm success, but also their diversification as well as insects diversification. That's because specific flowers attract specific insects, and any new color or adaptation led to the attraction potentially of a different insect than it did before. And eventually, because the insects determine what flowers get fertilized, populations would become isolated from each other and speciation would occur. Speciation is the development of a new species when a population is isolated from another and no longer reproduces with that other population. New species were forming all the time in both groups, angiosperms and insects, because it works both ways. Insects and angiosperms accelerated each other's speciation and diversification. Moving on from plants to invertebrates now. Invertebrates that underwent major changes in the Cretaceous include forams. Both benthic and planktonic forams underwent major advances and diversifications in the Cretaceous. Unfortunately, later on, they were hit hard in the in-Cretaceous extinction, which we'll talk about in the next video about that extinction event. But also, burrowing bivalves were able to evolve adaptations like burrowing more rapidly and deeper into the sediment. This came because of the increasing threat of predation and the increasing skills of predators and speed and ability to dig on the part of the predator. So predation is a very important thing for driving evolutionary changes and adaptations in prey type species like these bivalves here. Another major change in mollusks was in the gastropod group. Neogastropods, the most recent major group of gastropods that I talk about in my bivalve and gastropod video that I'll link up here if you want to check out, evolved in the Cretaceous period. Chelostome bryozoans, which is one of the major group of bryozoans that is one of the most abundant modern bryozoans on Earth today, evolved in the Cretaceous period. I talk about those in my bryozoan video. I'll link it up here if you want to check it out. Crabs became more modernized during this period. And last but definitely not least, mollusks, specifically bivalves known as rudists, became the dominant reef-building organisms in the Cretaceous period. Why did rudists rule reefs? Oh, that's hard to say. Rudists ruled reefs. Why did they rule the reefs during the Cretaceous period if we know that today corals are the dominant reef-building organisms? It all comes back to the magnesium to calcium ratio of the ocean during the Cretaceous. Again, the low magnesium to calcium ratio during this time favored calcite precipitation, which the rudists did. However, corals, which like to precipitate aragonite rather than calcite, are more easily able to form their skeletons in conditions where the magnesium to calcium ratio is higher, like after the Cretaceous period in the Cenozoic until today. And rudist reefs, as well as just rudists themselves, unfortunately went extinct at the end of the Cretaceous during the major extinction event during that time. And nothing like them ever really made a comeback again, because aragonite precipitation since that time has been favored and corals have been the major reef builders since then. And I just realized I never actually mentioned this, but calcite and aragonite are basically both calcium carbonate minerals. They're the same composition. They just differ in their structure. And some organisms precipitate calcite and some precipitate aragonite. And I should have mentioned that earlier, but that's the difference between the two. They're the same composition. They're just different structures. Moving on to what I'm sure all of you have been waiting for, the vertebrates. The Cretaceous vertebrates included marine predators that were forcing invertebrates like this brachiopod here to adapt in ways like evolving spines or evolving the ability to swim or burrow more rapidly or deeply into the sediment. And because of this increase in predation and increase in evolutionary adaptations of predators, by the end of the Cretaceous, very few sedentary animals lived on the seafloor. They were all trying to move in some way because they just couldn't survive anymore if they were just sitting on the seafloor. They had to be able to move away from predators or burrow away from predators or have some sort of defense mechanism like spines. Not all predators, however, were vertebrates like this mosasaur here, which we'll talk about in a second. Many predators were invertebrates like this ammonite here that the guy is eating. Ammonites were major predators during the entire Mesozoic, not just the Cretaceous. And other mollusks like this little gastropod here was also a predator, eating this worm here or even boring into other mollusks to eat them. I mean, geez, guys, calm down. Then there's some that were both predator and prey, evolving spines for defense and claws for hunting and crushing prey. But the top predators in the Cretaceous included mosasaur, as shown here, ichthyosaur, dinosaurs, which kind of look like a reptilian dolphin, plesiosaurs, as shown here, and crocodiles, only one of which still lives today. I'll let you guys figure out which one. But as you can see, the crocodiles here were absolutely huge. They were large enough for their prey at the time. Now, this might be an exaggeration, I'm not exactly sure, but I know for a fact they were way bigger back then because they were eating things that were much larger. I mean, dinosaurs were freaking huge, guys. So was mosasaurs. Mosasaurs were absolutely huge. If you know from my cephalopods video, you've seen that these ammonites could get to 18 meters in length. And if that guy's 18 meters, just imagine how big that mosasaur is. Yeah, I'll let you work that one out yourself. But in any case, the point here is, as time went on, the one dude here that survived into modern day, the crocodile, scaled down in size during the Cenozoic when their prey became smaller. Why would it be beneficial to scale down? Well, speed is basically the main thing. If their prey is smaller and they don't need to be as big, they might as well gain the speed advantage and become smaller so that they can still have their prey, because they're still bigger than their prey, but small enough to move a little quicker than they were before. The hunting strategy, though, remained largely the same in the Cretaceous as it does today. They would ambush their prey at the water's margin. Modern equivalents to these predators today include dolphins for the ichthyosaur. Again, crocodiles are still living today. And for the mosasaur here, I list both sharks and whales because based on what we know about mosasaurs, they probably did ambush attacks on their prey, kind of like great white sharks do today, but their size and niche in the ocean was largely similar to whales. And overall, it's clear that marine reptiles, ichthyosaurs, plesiosaurs, and mosasaurs filled the niche that today is filled by marine mammals, whales, dolphins, and the like. Marine reptiles are not at all common today after the end Cretaceous extinction. Many of these guys went extinct, and only sea turtles and sea snakes still live as marine reptiles today. And now getting to the actual thing I'm sure you guys have been waiting for, the thing that is all over my shirt, the dinosaurs in the Cretaceous period. Just like the ocean, the terrestrial realm was home to animals that were replaced in the Cenozoic. Dinosaurs dominated the terrestrial realm during this time, but were later replaced by mammals during the Cenozoic. Instead of antelopes, zebras, and wildebeest herds that we see today, there were herds of duck-billed dinosaurs, as shown in this picture here. And instead of the horned rhinos, you had horned dinos, like triceratops, that played the role of the Cretaceous unicorns. Instead of lions as your top predator, you had Tyrannosaurus, which not only included Tyrannosaurus rex as a species, but this genus included many Tyrannosaurus species that were just pretty terrifying, I'm sure, to those poor little herds of horned dinosaurs. And what is that in the sky there? A bird or a dinosaur? Well, I'm sure some of you know this. I'm still surprised that this isn't common knowledge, but they're the same thing. Birds are dinosaurs. If you want to go see a modern day dinosaur, go outside and look at a blue jay, because it's a dinosaur. This is why when most paleontologists speak about the dinosaurs' extinction, they say the extinction of the non-avian dinosaurs, not just the extinction of the dinosaurs, because they're not completely extinct. The oldest known true bird evolved around 150 million years ago and was called Archaeopteryx. However, as we now know, birds are not the only dinosaurs that had feathers. Many of the dinosaurs had feathers. We just didn't know that because feathers don't typically preserve in the rock record. And now we know that. And now, you know, movies like Jurassic Park and Jurassic World would look a little funny if all the dinosaurs had feathers on them. But, you know, that's just the way it was. If you want to know more about dinosaur evolution, I talk more specifically about that in my Mesozoic video. I'll link it up here if you want to check it out. But moving on to mammals. Mammals didn't wait till the dinosaurs largely went extinct to evolve. They just had to wait until most of the dinosaurs went extinct to dominate. However, during the Mesozoic, mammals were around. They had evolved by the Triassic, the first period in the Mesozoic, but were forced to stay small in size due to the dominant dinosaurs. However, like I mentioned, in the late Cretaceous, or basically the end Cretaceous, the tables were turned as dinosaurs largely went extinct and mammals were able to fill the niches that the dinosaurs filled in the Mesozoic throughout the Cenozoic and until today. And that's why we are possible and living. Mesozoic mammals, however, included both herbivores and carnivores, and they fed on seeds and nuts provided by the flourishing angiosperms. Thank you, angiosperms. And the carnivores fed on small dinosaurs, as we can see in this picture. picture to the top right. After the end Cretaceous extinction event, mammals took over the terrestrial realm and diversified even more as the continents split. It wasn't just the dinosaurs largely disappearing that helped the mammals dominate and diversify in the Cenozoic. The continents were splitting more, which I talk about in my Cretaceous paleogeography video. It may or may not be out by the time you're watching this, but as the continents split more in the late Cretaceous to early Cenozoic, population isolation events happened more often, and therefore speciation happened more often. And as we mentioned earlier, speciation is the formation of new species and therefore the diversification of mammals. If you want to know more about how the continents were arranged, when they were splitting up, and how this change and split in continents affected climate in the Cretaceous period, you can check out my Cretaceous paleogeography video. And if you want to know more, which I know you do, about the end Cretaceous extinction event, you can check out that video as well. If they're out by now, I'll try and put them up here on the screen for you so you can just click them. And if they're not up here on the screen, check out my channel. If they're not there yet, they'll come out very soon. The major reference I'm using to make this video and others in this playlist is Earth Systems History, linked in my description below if you're interested, as well as other minor and supporting references. They're always in my description. And with that, guys, I thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next video. Bye.